Quando sei lontana sogno all'orizzonte manca le parole. Io sì lo so che sei con me, con me. Tu mia luna, tu sei qui con me.
Andrea Bocelli and Sarah Brightman there, sounding fantastic, although I suspect you're going to have to take my word for it, because through YouTube compression and this crappy little microphone that I'm wearing, I don't think it will sound that great. Welcome to A British Audio File. This is part 5 in a series of videos where I'm looking at what it takes to put together a hi-fi system. In section 5, I'd like to discuss loudspeaker enclosures. Now, I'm going to restrict this discussion to conventional box speakers, ported and sealed box designs. I'm aware that there's dipoles, bipoles, omnidirectional, open baffle, planar magnetic, electrostatic speakers out there, but they're more specialist designs. And I think by focusing just on ported and sealed enclosures, we're covering most of the speakers that most people will be considering. Now, you have to bear with me a second. Those of you who have seen maybe one or two of my other videos, be aware that I don't script this stuff, but what I do is pop on a post-it some kind of heading notes, so I've got kind of some structure to refer to, and there's quite a bit to get through today, so I am going to have to refer to this at times. So what's the benefit of a sealed box versus a ported design and vice versa? Well, in a sealed box, the back energy created from the woofer primarily is trapped inside the box and dissipated as heat. In a ported design, that energy is used, it's through the tuning frequency of the port to extend the bass response. So a ported design is more efficient and it has a more extended bass response than a sealed enclosure. The bass frequencies fall off more dramatically on a ported design and more gradually on a sealed box enclosure. And the benefit that a sealed box enclosure has over a ported design is that it has a quicker transient response, because the pressure inside the box is used to move the woofer in and out more quickly. So there's pluses and minuses to both sides. Now, it may be obvious to some, less obvious to others, that if you've got a rear ported design, you may not want to place that too close to the wall behind the speaker. Why is that the case? Now, to understand that, we need to understand a little bit about the relationship between frequency and wavelength and how a loudspeaker treats different wavelengths differently. So our human hearing is typically 20 hertz to 20,000 hertz, ideally. It rolls off as you get older. A 20 hertz signal translates to a 17 meter wave. A 200 hertz signal translates into 1.7 meters. 2000 hertz is 17 centimeters, and 20,000 hertz is 1.7 centimeters. Now, it's probably difficult to try and get your head around a speaker of that size producing a 17 meter wave, but it does. So let's flip things around a little bit and imagine a 17 meter water wave trying to be blocked by that speaker. What would happen? Well, the reality is that that speaker is going to have very little impact on a 17 meter wave. It's just going to wrap around that speaker and keep on going. Even a 1.7 meter wave, which translates to 200 hertz, some energy is going to be reflected off the front baffle of that speaker, but the majority of energy is going to wrap around that speaker and keep going. At 2000 hertz, which relates to 17 centimeters, well, now you're looking at wavelengths which are similar to the wavelength of the width of the front baffle of that speaker. So 17 centimeter wave is going to hit that front baffle and bounce back off, and that's going to be true of wavelengths in excess of that. So wavelengths shorter than that, frequencies in excess of that. So what I'm trying to say is that the bass frequencies are omnidirectional. We call that a 4π spherical response, and the high frequencies are semi-hemispherical, 2π response, and they behave a bit more like a laser beam. Now, to try and understand that, I use the analogy of a pinhole camera. If you remember back to science class, where you placed a pinhole in a box shone a light through it, placed an object in front of the light to project an image onto a screen. The reason that works is because the wavelength of light is so small and the frequency is so high that they're able to pass through that tiny aperture unencumbered. As the wavelength increases, you get diffraction and dispersion, and that's essentially how a loudspeaker works. At high frequency, they act like a laser beam, and as the frequency drops down, you're going to get more dispersion of that sound and more diffraction. It's going to wrap around and the speaker more. So that essentially is how a loudspeaker responds to different frequencies and wavelengths. What happens as you place a speaker closer and closer to a wall? Well, what you're reducing is the 4π response and increasing the 2π response by placing the speaker closer to the wall. Because the wavelengths are so large at low frequencies, that wall behind the speaker almost acts like a front baffle. So it's projecting more sound energy outwards. And the other thing that happens is as sound bounces off a wall, it comes back out of phase. So that omnidirectional response on the bass, what you're actually getting is a cancellation effect when the speaker's further out from the wall, because as it bounces off the back wall and comes back, there's going to be cancellation due to the two signals being out of phase. Now, you need to be a little bit careful, because if you remember in my part 3 of these videos, we talked about maintaining a certain distance from the wall in order to create a delay in early reflections. Now, and the delay we wanted was a minimum of 5 milliseconds. That translates to a distance from the front of your speaker, not the back, so the front that's producing the sound, to the wall behind it of a minimum of 0.9 meters to maintain that 5 millisecond delay. As you move speakers closer to the wall than that, the delay becomes less than 5 milliseconds. And what that does is it basically messes with stereo imaging and transient response, because anything less than 5 milliseconds will be considered direct sound. So you have to be careful. You can move the speakers closer to the wall to get better bass response, but you need to maintain a certain amount of distance to delay those early reflections, as I said. A rear-ported speaker throws out more energy in behind the speaker. So you're just exacerbating problems by placing a rear-ported speaker closer to a wall. So hopefully you found this video useful in terms of determining what type of speaker enclosure you might choose that might suit your room and your setup. I think I've covered what I want to speak about today. So for today and for now, a British Audiophile signing off.